Hello and the greetings, everyone, and welcome to today's Biofuel Producers Program webinar. Thank you again for joining us today. I would now like to introduce and turn the presentation over to Rural Business and Cooperative Service Administrator, Dr. Karama Neal.
Thank you so much. We are so pleased to have each of you here. We really appreciate your interest in this important new program. Again, I'm Karama Neal, Administrator for Rural Business Cooperative Service. We are really thrilled to be able to talk with you today about the new Biofuel Producer Program. Under the leadership of President Biden, Vice President Harris, and Secretary Vilsack, USDA is providing direct relief to the people of rural America who are still reeling from the economic impacts of the pandemic. As we rebuild the nation's economy, USDA is targeting resources and investments to improve the strength and the resiliency of America's sustainable fuel markets. By investing in sustainable fuel markets and biofuel production, we can reduce greenhouse gas emissions, expand America's energy independence, and combat the impacts of climate change. As we all know, the pandemic has created unprecedented economic disruptions for the people in rural America, including agricultural producers who are leading our nation's transition to cleaner sources of energy. As an example, USDA's Office of the Chief Economist estimates that the biofuel stock sector saw a $4.4 billion drop in gross revenue between 2019 and 2020. Ethanol producers were especially hard hit. For example, ethanol production in April 2020 was just 55% of what it was in April 2019. The relief we're discussing today will pave the way to economic recovery for America's biofuel producers, stimulate a critical market for U.S. farmers and ranchers, and move the country closer to President Biden's goal of net zero carbon emissions by 2050. USDA is using funding from the CARES Act to make $700 million in direct payments available for biofuel producers who experienced unexpected market losses due to the pandemic. We'll share more on the details of those payments shortly, but first I'd like to introduce Doug McCaleb, Senior Advisor in the Office of the Secretary. Most recently, McCaleb was Senior Advisor in Animal Plant and Health Inspection Service and previously served as Senior Policy Advisor for Rural Affairs at the White House Domestic Policy Council. So again, Doug has provided wonderful leadership, really excellent, strong leadership in this area, and we're really pleased to have him here to share our perspectives from the Secretary's office. Doug?
Thank you so much, Dr. Neal. I really appreciate that introduction, and thank you to you and your team for all the hard work that you have put into this program. I'm especially pleased to be here this afternoon. I'm pleased all the stakeholders are part of the session because that means we have a program up and running and advertised and out, which is really an important thing. The market losses that many biofuels producers experienced over the course of the pandemic were very devastating. And getting this initiative up and running is really critical. When the legislation first passed, there was not a dollar amount affixed to it. There wasn't a whole lot of legislative specifics. There were even questions of whether the executive branch would implement the provision or not. And looking ahead, a lot of questions as to whether after the presidential transition, would USDA implement this program. And I just wanted to share that Secretary Vilsack made it very clear to our team the importance and the strength that this program needed to take on. And it was through that process that we identified nearly $750 million that would be identified to support biofuels producers assistance. A lot of work had to go into this from this part of the agency, and RD did really yeoman's work taking this on. For a one-time initiative, that would be the scope and the size of it, just a massive task for our agency personnel to take on. And we really appreciate all the tenacity that they showed. I really appreciate all the patience and flexibility that our stakeholders showed as well. Recognizing there were many delays that weren't the doing of RD, not even the doing of USDA, but circumstances beyond our control. So we're just happy to be here today to get to talk about the program in clear specifics and a chance to hear and to help with any guidance or questions that stakeholders might have on how to apply for the program. As we have this conversation, I think it's important to recognize that no program can be all things to all people. In my 28 years of service with USDA, I'm not sure I've seen a program that could be all things to all people, but rest assured, we spent very extensive time doing economic analysis and program analysis to answer a lot of unknown questions that came from the legislative text, to take a look at how would we structure eligibility for the program, how would we capture the losses that many of the biofuels producers incurred, how would we value those losses, and then most importantly, how would we structure the actual funding going out to those companies that experienced such difficult times throughout the pandemic. Our goal was clearly to make it the approach as equitable as possible and to be guided by the principle that whatever we did would have to be legal, would have to be in the wheelhouse of USDA, would have to be doable, and most important, would have to make a difference for the producers out there who suffered tough times. So, you know, again, no program being all things to all people, we feel very strongly about the program that we've arrived at. And again, a lot of hard work and thinking went into getting us to this day here today. For any of you joining the webinar that have the expectation that this will fully make losses whole, I just want to be clear that we recognize, I don't think any pandemic program can make those promises. Our goal is to try to help producers recoup some of the losses that they incurred and to provide some stability and support for what is a really important industry for rural America and for our country as a whole. So we have 60 days now for you all to be applying for the program. Our program today here, the webinar, chance to connect with you. For our rural development team to provide an overview and specifics about how the program operates. We want to answer questions that we can for those questions that can be traced back directly to the Federal Register notice in the NOFA language. We'll do that here today. I recognize many of the questions are going to require a lot further thinking and a lot further deliberation. So if we get those kinds of questions, we'll commit to getting back to you all. I think we would like to be able to post answers to a website sort of an FAQ so that everyone has benefit of responses together at the same time. But our goal is to ensure as much access to this as possible. We want to have as many producers be eligible, make sure that the NOFA application process works for everyone. And so we are going to learn from you throughout the course of this webinar, again, help provide guidance where we can, and if necessary, see what further actions might be needed on our part to make sure the program works well for everybody. Because again, you know, given the time periods here, this isn't like a farm bill where we maybe take a year and a half to write a rule and then have a sign up 2 years afterward. We had to pull this together without, you know, the benefit of having a federal advisory committee, for example, and not having access to necessarily all the data that we look forward to getting from you through the course of the sign up. So this session today is going to help provide a chance for us to share and will help set a basis for next steps going forward. And before I turn it over to Mark Brzezinski with RD, I would just also say that we also have a $100 million infrastructure program coming shortly as well. So again, very strong emphasis on assistance to biofuels. This is something very important to the administration. And we're all just very happy that you're on the webinar today and looking forward to the dialogue. So with that, I'll turn it over to Mark Brzezinski with the Rural Development, who has been doing a lot of the work with his team to get us to where we are today to be able to discuss program specifics. Mark, do you want to take it away?
Very good. Thank you, Doug. We're so grateful that you're able to join us and share the insights on the program, kind of the stand up of the program. Yes, it has been kind of a little bit of a bumpy road getting to where we are, just with the first as far as the limited guidance, yes, in the statute or in the funding source, but simply in, I think, trying to structure this to meet the needs of producers the best we really can. Today, as we noted, we're going to walk through the presentation. If we can flip to the next slide, would be great. Thank you. We're going to spend a little bit of time, again, kind of an overview. We'll try to highlight the best we can as far as what we described or defined as applicant eligibility for the program, of course, and the biofuel eligibility. I'm going to be joined by my colleague, Lisa Noti, who's going to walk through then the process, talk about the applying, the application procedures, the forms needed for that. We already have been receiving some questions. We stood up the program website, come an intake for Q&A within that program. So we have some questions we've already received that we thought we'd share some of those. So I think that's going to help provide some insights working forward. And as Doug and Caleb indicated, we know there are some questions coming in that we don't have a set answer for yet, that we may need to undertake some more deliberations here, try to craft a little bit more guidance for that, and we'll do so. And there may be some questions coming in today that we'll add to that list. About our intention, and we will keep our website up to date as to as we are developing guidance and trying to offer more clarity on some of the concerns, we'll make sure that we post that to our website. Okay, so with that, why don't we start off with an overview? So next slide, please. And one more. So the program itself, as we have talked introduction, is for the purpose of it is really to make payments to eligible biofuel producers, and we'll provide some additional insight as to both the biofuel income eligible producer piece of this, and the payments are to cover unexpected market loss, and again we'll provide a bit more definition around the market loss and how that's being calculated. But in short, kind of our next bullet here is we're looking at kind of two approaches, or basically a main approach and then a kind of a subset of that. So the baseline is to look at production of biofuel of 2020 compared to 2019. Intended this to be as clear and as say as clean or as simple as we possibly could. So we're looking at the full year's production. So a decrease in production from 2019 to 2020, that decrease would be what we're defining as market loss in terms of gallons of production. Now we also added an opportunity for producers that were that produced biofuel due to meeting requirements of contractual commitments or other commitments, ability to look at adding kind of that production as potential market loss, or at least some opportunities, and we'll define that here a little bit for you and provide a little more insight into that. As both Dr. Neal and Doug McKeelup indicated, there's $700 million available in this program. The program will be administered through the funding opportunity notice. So that's the notice that's not only invites the applications, but sets up the rules, requirements, procedures for the program. Again, that was published on Monday. That's also available off our website. The application window is a 60-day window. So a closing date of February 11th. And again, we'll walk through a little bit as to the application process and submitting of applications. Okay. How about our next slide, please? And one more. So starting with the applicant eligibility. So the applicant must be either an independent eligible producer, or the applicant is an entity or individual that owns and controls multiple eligible producers. So when we refer to an independent eligible producer, what we mean is basically a single entity. So it could be a single facility. It could be an entity that owns multiple facilities. But think of it as a single legal entity. And that is the entire structure, you know, of the ownership structure. If the structures are, you know, a holding company, multiple entities that are affiliated, that's where we're looking at the second line on here as to the entity then is the one entity that owns and controls multiple. So in this case, we're looking at really affiliated entities. So again, it comes down to control. So if there is an entity or an individual that owns and controls various entities, those need to be rolled up into a single application. And in that case, the kind of the controlling entity is the applicant for this program. And you can see an example here on our slide. So if we have a couple of LLCs that are operating but are owned by a parent LLC, that parent company would be the applicant in this program. Okay, let's go to the next slide, please. And in cases where we have applicants that operate multiple facilities, they need to report the production at all of their facilities. We may see some examples where if you own multiple facilities, maybe a single facility was closed for some time period in 2019 or in 2020. The reason we wanted to just look at the entire, so all the facilities need to be reported. So it's all production, all facilities under that applicant. And again, our calculation would be looking at total production for the years of 2020 and 2019. For the purposes of if there are sole proprietorships owning operations, the sole proprietorship also could be a legal entity in this program. Okay, next slide. There is a citizenship requirement as far as the ownership. So if the applicant is a sole proprietorship, then that individual, the applicant, must be a citizen or legally reside in the U.S. after legal admittance, again, for a sole proprietorship. If the entity or if it's a legal entity with ownership, then the individual owners, at least 51% of the individual owners of the legal entities, must be either citizens or legally admitted as permanent residents of the U.S. So there is a citizenship requirement on this, in this program. Thank you. Next slide. So again, a little bit more detail, and I'll walk through a couple examples as to how we're going to calculate our terminology around suffering and market loss. So again, at the high level, it's looking at a total production for the applicant of year ninth fiscal year or calendar year 2019 to 2020, and that difference would be considered the market loss. We have a second caveat, as I mentioned. So in 2020, for producers that produced to meet contractual requirements and that production resulted in a gross profit loss, in other words, you did not cover your cost of producing the products, that production also will be considered market loss. And we'll walk through a couple of examples here of both of those as to how that applies. So our next slide. There we go. Thank you. So at the, again, at the top level, and again, of course, our numbers, we're using some pretty small numbers just for illustration. We know yours are going to look probably significantly different. But looking at the market loss simply for the year or the 2 years in a comparison. So a simple example, if 2019 production was at 1 million gallons, 2020 was 900,000, the difference, 100,000, is the market loss. And that is basically what the program will do is calculate the market loss for every applicant. We're then going to total kind of the bottom line of the volume of market loss for each applicant into a grand total and simply take the dollars available, the 700 million, divide that by the gallons. That'll calculate or result in a calculation of a payment per gallon for the entire pool for all applicants. And then we'll, of course, take that price per gallon or payment per gallon back to each individual applicant for their market loss. Our next slide. To illustrate, again, a simple example of how the loss based on a contractual commitment would work. First of all, we're going to test looking at the gross profit loss. So really the starting point, really are the right three columns on this slide. So we'll look at the sales revenue minus the cost of goods sold, kind of the variable cost piece. If that results in a negative gross profit, then that fuel produced is eligible as market loss. So in this example, we were showing 200,000 gallons produced that suffered this loss. So that 200,000 would then be considered as part of the loss for that applicant. Our next slide. And just to highlight a few details, you saw some asterisks on the headers there, some definitions. So when we're referring to sales revenue, we're including sales of all products, could include byproducts, you know, such as any revenues from distiller's grains, CO2, if you have sales or other related products, would all include within the revenue. And of course, the cost of goods sold would be the cost related to that production. So starting with your feedstock and raw costs, any manufacturing costs associated with that. The cost of goods sold, of course, would not include your fixed costs going forward. Okay. And next slide. And again, a little bit more detail into some of those definitions and terms. As we stated, the gross profit loss would be calculated taking the sales revenue less cost of goods sold. And again, we're only including the variable cost, not the fixed cost associated with production. Sales revenue would include fuel and any other co-products or other revenues from that production. cost of goods sold will include all material costs and other costs associated with the kind of variable of producing those products. Would not include fixed costs. You know, some examples here we're showing. Maybe others might be taxes, interest on your fixed debt, et cetera, you know, would not be considered. And of course, the variable costs or the cost of goods sold are the variable costs, those that are directly associated with the production of your products. We will need to have applicants provide some additional materials and supporting documentation if they're claiming loss due to contractual commitments. And that would include the financial statements supporting the loss along with contracts and other materials. Okay. Now, next slide, thank you. And this is then just, a very simple example of looking at an example of illustrating a law or an applicant that had both a production loss and a loss from production meeting their contractual requirements. So again, the baseline I was starting at is comparing the 2 years of 19 to 20. They were showing a decrease, a loss of 100,000 gallons in 2020. But in that 2020, they also produced 200,000 gallons at a gross profit loss. So we're adding that to the loss, and our payment then would be based on a total loss of 300,000 gallons for the year. Okay, our next slide. So when we're defining as far as eligible producers, sometimes it's helpful to look at what's not eligible. So a entity that exclusively, so they only contract for production of biofuel, and the production is by a third party. So they're contracting for a third party to produce biofuel. That individual that's doing the contracting is not an eligible producer. They're not eligible to apply for this program. The actual third party that is processing or producing the biofuel is the eligible producer. If you have an entity that does a little bit of both, where they're producing and contracting, this is the same rule, is that the third party that's actually doing the production of the biofuel is eligible for that piece of the biofuel. Likewise, a sole proprietor or an entity that blends, otherwise combines biofuel into blended biofuels, blending of biofuels and distribution of fuels is not eligible under this program. Next slide. And the biofuel, types of biofuel that are eligible for the program. One more. This program utilizes the definitions of biofuel as established under the Clean Air Act. So it's renewable fuel produced from renewable biomass, and it has to be fuel that's used to replace or reduce the quantity of fossil fuel in transportation fuel. It can include advanced biofuels, biomass-based diesel fuel, cellulosic biofuel, and conventional biofuels. So conventional biofuel, of course, would be what we're referring to as corn kernel ethanol. So ethanol, biodiesel from various sources will be eligible for the program. Again, we're going back to the Clean Air Act definition. So it's fuel that's used in the transportation industry. All right, so with that, I'm going to turn over to Lisa. Lisa's going to walk through a little bit of the application process, the procedures for that, a little bit of a Q&A, and then we'll take a look at the questions that you're dropping those into the Q&A box. So thank you. Lisa?
Good afternoon, everyone. As Mark said, we're going to talk about the items that go into an application. So one of the first things that applicants need is a DUNS number. A DUNS number is something that is assigned from Dun & Bradstreet. The slide gives the phone number if you need to register via phone, or there's a website that can be used to set up a DUNS. Next slide. Applicants will also need to be registered in the system for award management. If you've previously registered, we recommend that you check and make sure that your DUNS registration is active. If you're not familiar with this system, it's an identity verification system, and it's been enhanced with several standard representations and certifications that correspond with federal grant and payment awards. There should be no cost associated with registering in SAM, but since it's a validation process, it does take a little bit of time for it to get an active registration. Next slide. This slide contains the link from the website. If you haven't already been there, that's kind of what your opening page will look like. The application material that can be found here, specifically under the To Apply tab. There's an application guide and forms that are needed, and then there's a short checklist. Next slide. This slide covers the forms that are required. There's just a handful of forms. The biofuel producer payment, or excuse me, program application. Taylor, can you bring up the application? It's the 4288-7. It's a 5-page document. Pages 4 and 5 are Part B attachment and are facility specific. One that will need to be completed for each facility. So she's scrolling through it. We want page 4. There we go. So that's the part that you're going to complete for each facility that's involved with the applicant. Okay, so scroll back up to page 1, please, Taylor. So page 1 is just basic information on the applicant. Page two contains 3 tables. In the first table, we're going to identify the facilities that are part of the application. And so each of the facilities that are listed there will need that Part B attachment, that page 4 and 5 of this document. In the second table, will be completed if the applicant is applying for assistance based on decreased production. It should be completed for the applicant as a summary of all the facilities. Basically, what's being entered here is the table is the production volumes from 2019 and 2020. They relate to all facilities. The third table on this page contains information on production related to contractual obligations. Again, this rolls up to the applicant. So a summary of Part B attachments. Page three is certifications. The items that are being certified roll up to the requirements in the notice regarding citizenship, things that relate to eligibility as a producer, and the biofuel being eligible. And directly under the certifications is the signature section. And then we're back to page 4, which is the Part B attachment, which mirrors what's in page 2, but a little bit more detail where you're identifying the information on this facility, what's being produced at it, and then the specific information. And then page 5 is set up to check the applicable areas that relate to the specific type of biofuel that's being produced. So just to reiterate, we're going to prepare a Part B attachment for each facility, regardless of whether assistance is being sought or not, regardless of whether it had a production decrease or not. Okay, so let's go back to the PowerPoint, please. The second form then is the assurance agreement. That's where we're ascertaining that you agree to comply with the federal civil rights laws. The third form is restrictions on lobbying. If you access this third form from the website, it actually opens up into, I believe it's an 11-page document, and it's the certification on page 6 that we actually need to sign. So depending on how you, what you have related to this, the 1940Q certification, you may or may not need the SFLLL because that relates to lobbying. The last form listed here, the final one, is probably the most important one. That's the ACH enrollment form, with the instructions to us on where the money goes. We need at least some of the payee information, so we make sure we have the correct payee. We also need the financial institution information, but nothing in that top section on agency information. It's kind of set up in three different parts, but we just need most of it in the lower two parts. So that pretty well takes care of the forms. So the next slide talks about supporting documentation. If a producer is applying for assistance based on decreased production, supporting documentation for 2019 and 2020 production, we envision this would be something like a monthly spreadsheet. Most producers already have something like this. It's certainly not necessary to recreate it if you have it. If you're a producer who participates in our advanced biofuel payment program, most likely whatever you submit for that would be sufficient for this section also. If an application is being developed requesting assistance for production that was due to contractual obligations, we'll need copies of the contracts, the financial statements, documentation on the cost of goods sold, and anything else that you think is relevant to the request. Next slide. Once everything has been assembled, then it will be submitted as an email attachment, and the email goes to the energyprograms@usda.gov inbox. And we will set that up so that there is an acknowledgement sent from that, acknowledging that it was received. So that pretty well summarizes the application process. So we thought we'd take a few minutes and go through some of the questions that have been asked and share the responses we've developed. So go ahead to this next slide, please. One of the questions regarding biofuel eligibility, is biodiesel used for heating fuel eligible for assistance? Our response is only biofuel used in the transportation industry, replacing fossil fuel usage is eligible for assistance. And this goes back to the legislation that cross-references the Clean Air Act. Next slide. Another question, would renewable natural gas from an anaerobic digester be eligible? No, again, only biofuel used in the transportation industry is eligible. Next slide. Are only RFS eligible biofuel gallons to be counted in determining the volume of market loss? Please verify that alcohol produced for non-fuel uses cannot be counted in determining 2019 and 2020 production levels. Only biofuels used in the transportation industry are eligible. We cannot count sanitizers, cleansers, beverage, any of those when we calculate the 2019 and 2020. So that goes aside. Next slide. So this relates to one of the slides that Mark went over earlier, that it was asking for some clarification on fixed and variable expenses. Again, you know, just kind of going over those, gross profit is revenue minus cost of goods. Includes only variable costs, not fixed costs. We give some examples of fixed costs, variable costs, but be consistent with the operating statements. Next slide. Some producers continue to operate at or near full capacity during the pandemic to ensure continued availability of co-products. Revenues associated with the sale of the co-product, some producers were able to break even or minimize losses. Are those producers who ensured continuous production deemed critical? How do they fit in? This would be an example of a producer applying for benefits based on contractual commitments that resulted in a gross profit loss. So the application would need to contain the contracts for the production, and then the financial statements to support a gross profit loss. Next slide. A producer added production late in 2019, so cannot demonstrate qualifying production loss, can they still be eligible? If the producer produced in 2020 because of contractual requirements that resulted in the gross profit loss, then they could be eligible. They just need to support the application. Next slide. Producer had an overall increase in production and profit in 2020, but during 2 months produced at a gross profit loss. Would this producer be eligible for assistance? The producer could be eligible under the produced under contractual commitment, and basically we would need to support that. Next slide. Our facility produced non-transportation fuel product in 2019 and then moved into ethanol production in 2020. Are we eligible for assistance? Again, it's going to relate to production based on contractual commitments that resulted in a gross profit loss. So the application will need to show that. Next slide. What language or terms must a contract contain to meet contractual requirements to produce? If a producer has a contract to sell 100% of the product they produced, but is not a specific number of gallons, is that a contractual commitment? We're looking to the contract to verify the contractual obligation to produce. So the application will need to contain the amount of gallons produced under the contract that results in the gross profit loss. The contract will be used to validate the contractual requirement, and the financial documents will demonstrate the gross profit loss. Next slide. This relates to information submitted by applicants regarding their operations, financial agreements, contracts, production margins, et cetera, will be treated as confidential business information. So information provided with applications is subject to Freedom of Information Act. If you have concerns about what you're submitting, we can coordinate a discussion with the staff that oversee the FOIA request and provide some assurances. Next slide. What is the maximum benefit that a producer can receive? The notice talks about that. It caps the benefits at $50 million to any one producer. Next slide. So we'll open it up to questions, questions that are in the chat.
Okay, Lisa, why don't we kind of roll through some of the questions in the chat, and then we'll check with Taylor to see if there are others that wish to ask questions orally. Maybe for this, I'll try to summarize some of the questions. If you want to start off with some answers as we go through, that may be helpful. First of all, we can readdress the guidance regarding applicants as to when we're looking at that the applicant should be the independent producer or when it would be a kind of a ownership controlling entity of producers, kind of differentiating those. And of course, with that then is, you know, we talk about affiliates, ownership structures as to what's an affiliate in those definitions. Can you start with that one, please?
So the notice talks about if a producer is owned and controlled, that the entity that owns and controls will be the applicant, and they will use they will roll all of their entities into that application. So again, it goes back to the ownership and control.
Okay, so if there's the structure is a single entity engaged in biofuel production that's owned by another entity, but that parent entity doesn't own any other producers, just that one. Who would be the applicant? Would be the independent producer, right?
Yeah, okay. I would agree with that, Mark. We would have the independent producer be the applicant in that situation.
Right. So then if you're kind of multiplying that, so if the owner owned multiple entities, so let's LLC 1, LLC 2, LLC 3, and all three were engaged in production of eligible biofuel, then it would be the controlling entity, kind of the parent entity, would be the applicant for this program.
Right, agreed.
Okay. I think you addressed kind of some of the examples, and some of these questions came in, I think, before we covered the full presentation. So some of these may be already answered, but maybe just to summarize them a bit. We know that some owners' facilities expanded over the time period, because not only are we talking about a two-year period of comparing a production of 2020 to 2019, but we're also about a year beyond that, you know, now. So changes in capacities. So some of the questions are around operations that increased capacity in 2020, how are we going to calculate market loss? So I think there the guidance would be, again, if it's the overall looking at production, it's strictly looking at gallons produced 2019 to 2020, kind of regardless of the change in capacity. That's the kind of the entry point. But for those that had an increase in capacity, if part of your production is due to meeting contractual requirements and produced at a financial loss or a gross profit loss, that production could be yet eligible and included for payment. So it's kind of a, for those of you that are operating at a loss due to contractual commitments, again, that is a carve out that could be added in addition to the kind of the calculation of the comparison of a year to year. But if we're looking at the comparison of the year to year, it is the full year. So the top line was full year 2019 to 2020. The production at to meet contractual requirements is over the term of those contracts. So if the, or over the term of the loss. So if it was, let's say it's a full year contract that you had to meet, and during that period you had 3 months of production loss, those are the 3 months we would look at. There's some questions about financials, financial statements, financial information. The financial information is required for producers that are claiming the loss based on the gross profit loss. So if the loss is simply due to the market loss, you've got the top line comparing 19 to 2020, and that's the only request that's being submitted, we do not need, you know, financial statements. It's only when we go to the second level of looking at operating at a loss. Lisa, a question about RIN. So we refer to providing the RIN number for production. And the question is, are we asking for the RIN, the date the application is submitted?
Yes, it's talking about the most recent RIN. So if the most recent RIN is as of the date the application is submitted, then that's fine.
Okay. I will add to our discussion about and guidance on production due to a commitment of contracts. When we wrote that, we thought we were pretty broad in covering what's happening in the real world. But since publication of this notice on Monday, we've had some feedback as to there are some questions as to other areas of commitment, your market commitments that might not meet the that language strictly as to a contractual commitment. If you have that type of situation or a concern, let us know. We're glad to discuss it a little bit further. But we are engaged in deliberations here with leadership as to how to clarify some of those areas. So we are going to provide some additional guidance and clarification around that issue, along with we've had some discussions on change in ownership. Again, you know, we're talking about a three-year period of 19, 20, and 21. So there may be a change in ownership structures or restructuring of ownership in some facilities. And we don't have that addressed within the notice. Again, we are working with our legal counsel, trying to provide some additional guidance on that in those areas. And if we uncover others that need more clarification, we will prepare some guidance, and that'll be posted to the program website. Please do check into the website occasionally for additional guidance. There's some questions that relate to, I'm just going to describe them, more of either on ag production or on processing of oils and biomass to fuels. This program does not support the actual production to an ag producer. It does not provide funding or source of funding for production facilities for processing of biofuel. Again, we're looking at it's a program to support biofuel producers, but through looking at the loss of productions caused by the pandemic. Okay, a little bit on, I guess this is quite a good question on applying early. So there is a 60-day window. We will process all applications really at the same time. The methodology of this is we need to have all applications submitted. We need to calculate the market loss of each producer. We're then going to total that to calculate the actual payment amount per gallon to producers. So in essence, there's really not an advantage in applying early, other than we would strongly encourage you to at least get through the SAM registration and make sure those commitments are met. There could be some issues we've had occasionally, some applicants in other programs where maybe at one time they had a SAM registration, but it expired, trying to get things renewed. Occasional there's a glitch. We don't want someone to be hung up on those issues and unable to submit an application. Also, if you wait until towards the end, you may have questions that it's then going to be a little bit more difficult to address any specific questions for you. So we encourage you to work as soon as possible or as early as possible and let us know if you do have questions kind of rolling forward. This presentation is recorded and we'll post a recording to our program website. So on the website, there's an events tab. That's probably where you went to register for this. And we'll post this recording along with the PowerPoint slide itself if you want to review, back through that. Okay, Tyler, do you have anybody seeking to ask questions orally?
And yes, there are a couple of hands raised. We'll begin with Donna Funk.
Thank you. I just wanted to clarify that if a producer only produced fuel ethanol in 2019, but then in 2020, they produced fuel ethanol as well as hand sanitizer or something else. When they're doing their production comparison, they would exclude the hand sanitizer gallons from their 2020 production.
That is correct.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right, we do have another hand raised. Anthony Reed.
Okay, yes, this is Adam Cuffell, actually. But I'm speaking on behalf of our company here. And just I'm curious in terms of exported volume that would be for fuel use, is that to be included or not dependent on the production year? Because you may produce exports in one year and not in the other. So I just want to be straight in terms of the volumes being reported.
Right. And the reported volumes is production. Again, the fuel has to be a transportation fuel, but we do not have a test as to where it was used. So if it's used domestic or export, either would qualify. We're simply looking at the production level. Again, the purpose of the program is to really support your biofuel producers to maintain a market for ag commodities. So obviously exporting, the fuel would also meet that purpose of supporting, the market for ag commodities. So we're glad to clarify that for you, but yes, be either domestic or export.
All right, next up, Kim Du.
Hi, thanks for taking my question. It has to do with the definition of advanced biofuel on the Part B attachment for the application. Is that equivalent to the definition in Section 905, Advanced Biofuel Payment Program? That you also run?
Lisa, do you want to start them? Are you familiar with, you're more familiar with the forms than I am?
Yes, I would say it's a comparable term, but we have advanced biofuel that's eligible in that program that isn't necessarily utilized in the transportation industry. So the two programs are not exactly parallel, but the definition of advanced biofuel should be the same.
Thank you.
Answer the question.
Yeah.
Okay.
And next up, William Steiner.
Can you hear me? There.
We can.
I'm really curious. I know I recognize and acknowledge this program is for the biofuel producers. And I'm really curious to know if there's going to be one for biomass for ag grower producers. Those people provide what the biofuel producers need. And we certainly could use those kind of programs.
Yes, I definitely understand. Again, this program is trying to help address that, but more of an indirect. So it's by supporting the biofuel producer, we're supporting a market for, you know, biomass and ag commodities. But you're right, there are other considerations. We're not engaged, meaning our agency is not engaged today in activities. I know at the department level, I would suggest keep an eye on our program websites. There is a kind of a COVID relief website set up by USDA. And I see Doug popped on with camera, so maybe Doug may have more insight than me. So be glad to turn that one over, Doug.
I appreciate that, Mark. I appreciate the question. Lots of biomass programs and activities to come. So stay tuned for what we had here. Obviously, we have to trace back to the statutory language, which was very, very clear on the scope. But appreciate the question, and hopefully we'll be having some sessions to come here real quick to talk about more that's happening department-wide on biomass. Thanks.
Thank you.
All right, and next up, Michelle Kingdollar.
Hi there. I'm looking at the application on the very last page. It asks about the renewable identification number being established. And you've talked about the RINs a little bit, but I'm wondering what specific documentation is it looking for? Is it looking for a screenshot of our most recent generation or an email confirmation?
So in some of our other programs, we collect RIN reports. That would be fine. Screenshot would be fine. Basically documenting that we're going into that transportation industry.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, and next up, Michael Gross.
So, can you hear me?
We can.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for my question. My question is, does this program look at an entire year over year perspective, or would it be admissible to look at it on an interim period, like on a quarter over quarter perspective between 2020 and 2019? So if we've experienced a loss in the second quarter of 2020 and provided support for that as compared to 2019, is that acceptable?
So we have two approaches. So the base approach is looking at production loss, just straight production loss, and that is a full year, for year to year. We can't look at a quarter compared to a quarter, so it's for the full year. But if part of that production is production under a contract that resulted in a loss, that is for a specific time period. That's over the time period of the loss or the contract, whatever is being submitted. So for kind of the baseline, it's full year, but for the production loss based on a contractual commitment, that is for the identified time period that the applicant would identify. Okay, does that help?
Yes, thank you.
And there are no additional hands raised at this time.
Okay, let me just do a last check of see if any others came in through the chat. So again, some questions on kind of on the affiliation and ownership of entities. If you still have questions on that, feel free to connect with us either through the email on the website or direct. But what we're trying to express is that again, looking at ownership structures, if the legal entity is a single entity and is not affiliated with other producers, other biofuel producers, then it's that single entity is the applicant. If the biofuel producer is an entity that is affiliated with other producing entities, so again, like an LLC, LLC 1, LLC 2, and LLC 3 all produce biofuel, then it would be the parent company. So the entity that controls those would be the applicant in the program. And again, if that's not clear, if you have, I know there are maybe other structures that aren't quite that simple. If you have other questions around that, feel free to contact us and we'll be glad to work through your structures.
All right, okay. And Mark, we do have another hand.
Okay, sure.
James Kendrick, if you unmute yourself, we'll be able to hear you. I see you're unmuted, but we are unable to hear you.
Sure. Well, we'll buy him a little bit of time, maybe addressing, again, a couple questions that are around the looking at the calculating loss, so production at a loss. Again, the financials, looking at revenues and the cost of goods, all those issues only relate to claims around production under a contract, you know, through a contract commitment at a loss. You know, kind of the higher level, just simply looking at production of year to year, does not need that information. But if you are submitting a request to include production under a loss due to contractual commitments, that's where we look at the revenues, the cost of goods, and a gross profit loss. In that scenarios, the revenue includes all revenues, so it'd be fuel and other products, and then of course all costs associated under variable costs associated with cost of goods netted out from that to calculate the gross profit loss. And again, if you have examples where you're either concerned or questions with that, feel free to connect with us through the program chat. We'll connect one-on-one to help walk through any questions you have.
All right, we'll give Mr. Kendrick another opportunity here.
Yes, can you hear me now?
We can.
Okay, sorry about that. So I just wanted to ask a question in clarification to an answer that was given earlier about anaerobic digesters. I just wanted to make sure that I understood this correctly. If there is a biofuel produced and RINs are generated through RFS through that production of fuel for the transportation industry, if it's biogas that's produced in an anaerobic digester, it would qualify for this program or not?
I think we have your contact information. Let's circle back to that one. I have to go back, say again, we're using definition for the Clean Air Act, which is different than what we have for our other energy programs here within USDA. And that isn't apparent in the summary information we have. So we'll go back into the details of the Clean Air Act to answer that for you. And I think being that it came in a couple of times, Lisa, why don't we also put together maybe under our frequent asked questions on some guidance on that. So we'll respond back with some clarification for that one, okay?
And no additional hands raised at this time.
Okay. Lisa, anything that you would like to maybe highlight or close out with?
There's a couple of extra slides. Taylor, if you want to advance them, just to give some contact information. There we go. So there's my contact information. Jeff Carpenter is also working on the program. His contact information is listed there also. We encourage you to email questions through energyprograms at usda.gov, our website. We can monitor them between the two of us. Thank you all for your participation this afternoon. Hope everyone has a happy and safe holiday. Thank you.
Okay, any other last minute questions, Taylor?
No hands raised at this time.
Very good, very good. Well, we thank you all for joining. We're definitely appreciative of being able to offer the program and, of course, to offer some clarity and address any questions. Again, if you do have any questions, need any assistance, let us know. We're glad to connect and help through. And again, we know we have a few outstanding areas that need some clarifications, and we will post, you know, follow-ups to that to our website. Again, thank you. If you have questions, let us know. Take care.